먼저 소개를 해주셔서 감사드리고요. 그리고 멀리서 찾아와 주신 모든 패널분들 진심으로 감사드립니다. 저희가 애니메이션 하면은 사실 생각할 수 있는 가장 큰 나라가 일본이고요. 일본에서 애니메이션 토큰화를 진행하는 첫 번째 사례로 지금 참여해 주신 퀘스트리에서 뉴스가 저번 달에 미즈오 뱅크와 함께 협력을 시작했다라는 얘기를 들었습니다. 그리고 저희 행사 직전에 지금 끝에 계시는 아발란치를 통해서 토큰화를 하겠다라고 발표를 하셨는데 그 이유와 그리고 특히 애니메이션 영화를 제작하시려는 그 사유가 무엇인지를 좀 들어봤으면 좋겠습니다.
All right, thank you. So as I mentioned earlier presentation, now we are trying to make an anime fund with Mizuho Securities, one of the biggest financial institutions in Japan. And that anime fund is a traditional fund. And I also think this kind of contents and this kind of financial products to be tokenized in order to, you know, investors globally can, you know, invest in the Japanese contents. And I was wondering, you know, how to make this happen for like more than 2 years. And especially in Japan, the blockchain industry in Japan is very, I mean, how can I say, domestic. And I would like to, you know, use the public blockchain compared to the, you know, consortium or private blockchain, because that is the most important factor so that the investors globally can access to the Japanese security token. So I studied and learned, trying to study and trying to learn about the, you know, security token market globally. And I found the project called Project Guardian, which was, you know, the initiative of this project is Authority of Singapore, MAS, and the, you know, the big global financial company like JP Morgan and Citi and Apollo, which was, you know, close to me for my previous job, was seriously thinking about using Avalanche in the Project Guardian. And I studied about the Project Guardian and I approached the Avalanche Japanese team. And they taught me about, you know, like, you know, Justin mentioned today's presentation. They have a lot of use case with the financial institutions globally. So if I seriously think about launch an anime fund in Japan, we need to take a partnership with Avalanche. That's why we released the partnership our labs yesterday.
답변 감사합니다. 제가 우리나라에는 크립토를 하고 계신 많은 분들이 계신데요. 그분들 중에서 아발란체를 모르시는 분들은 없을 것 같아요. 그래서 네트워크로서 아발란체를 선택한 이유에 대해서 간략하게 말씀해 주셨고 그거에 대해서 아발란체에서는 어떠한 펀드를 토큰화할 때 장점이 있는지를 좀 듣고 싶습니다.
네, 감사합니다. 저도 편의상 저희 패널분들이 다 영어를 하시니까 영어로 답을 드릴게요. 어차피 다 지금 쓰시고 계신 것 같아가지고. So my name is Justin. I'm head of Asia for Avalabs. And Avalabs is a company behind Avalanche blockchain. And we support all the ecosystem projects on Avalanche. And that includes our work with KKR, one of the largest private equity funds being tokenized on public blockchain. Still under regulation and compliance with SEC RegT regulation. So that was the first work that we did with major financial institution 3 years ago. So we already knew that the major financial institutions want to do something on a public blockchain for some of the reasons, because when you tokenize a financial product on chain, it basically, in essence, solves two things. So when you put a financial product on blockchain, the paperwork goes away because this is the digital equivalent original copy of a paper. So there's no paperwork, and so it saves a lot of time and cost. And also when you tokenize a financial product and execute transactions, your payment equals settlement, meaning that your payment is settled with banks or between any financial institutions instantly. You don't need to have, or you don't need the help of third parties like brokers or agencies in between, and it leads into, it results in a lot of reduction in time and cost. So we had those experiences, and that finally led to our work with, like Mr. Ibe mentioned, our work with MAS, the Monetary Authority of Singapore, and their Project Guardian, where we worked with JP Morgan and Citi. And that was a different use case where we had to sort of customize the blockchain technology to fit the regulations. So we have the technology that works for the regulations, whether it is on a public blockchain or a customized separate satellite blockchain. Thank you.
답변 감사합니다. 저도 이제 스터디하면서 알게 된 게 KKR이나 해밀턴 랭이나 여러 가지 상품들이 이제 펀드 형태로 아발란체 위에 올라가 있는 것을 잘 알고 있고요. 이제 그런 것들을 봤을 때 혹시 애니메이션을 이제 펀딩하는 게 첫 사례가 맞는지, 그리고 좀 더 뭐 계획되고 있는 다른 것들이 더 있는지가 조금 궁금합니다. 네.
So he just asked about the use cases, whether also we have you ever tokenized animation or content creation as a fund or financial product. I don't think there was any case before Questree. So I think Questree is the first use case or first actual fund to support anime and content production in the whole world. And before that, but we have tokenized a lot of products as financial products that includes, we recently have tokenized the home equity. We recently have tokenized wines. We have tokenized sneakers like Air Jordans. I'm a big fan of sneakers. So that those already have been tokenized on blockchain. There's wine, there's diamond. So we are keep seeing actually the ongoing list of real world assets put on blockchain, and they enable very efficient trades, and it just creates a lot of efficiencies, saving time and saving cost again. Thank you.
말씀 감사합니다. 그 퀘스트리에 한 번 더 질문을 하고 싶은데요. 지금 이렇게 아발란체에 대한 장점을 많이 들었고, 또 퍼블릭 블록체인을 사용해서 토큰화를 하고 싶다는 얘기를 들었습니다. 그러면은 이제 토큰화를 했을 때 예상하고 있는 오퍼링이나 리스팅의 플랫폼을 혹시 고려하고 있는 일본이나 혹은 다른 해외에 그런 생각하시는 게 있는지 여쭤보고 싶습니다.
Yes, thank you. So when I try to, you know, negotiate with Mizuho Securities about a Japanese anime fund, actually, you know, they declined it because this is a really new product in Japanese financial space. And in the traditional financial space, you know, they are very, I mean, conservative about, you know, introducing a new financial product. But in this, you know, blockchain spaces, for example, the NFTs are not the financial product. So I'm trying to making a Japanese anime fund first, and then making this financial product to the security token, so that the, you know, people around the world can invest in the Japanese content. And I searched the security token exchanges all over the world. I found the INX in New York, and they are already you know, registered and regulated by SEC, which was really surprising to me. And more, they are, you know, using a self-custody wallet already. And this is really the future of the finance. So I hoped to list our security token to, you know, exchanges like INX in the future. We need to, you know, take steps from here. But the important thing is we are creating a financial product and then securitize and tokenize to the security token. This, you know, step is very important. So I would like to connect with any exchanges all over the world, like INX from here. But, you know, we need to make great examples from here. Is that okay? Thank you.
말씀 감사합니다. 지금 INX의 밥한테 한번 질문을 하고 싶은데요. 지금 퀘스트리에서 셀프 커스터디에 대한 말씀을 하셨어요. 그래서 셀프 커스터디가 왜 중요하고 INX가 왜 셀프 커스터디를 사용하고 있는지를 질문드리고 싶습니다.
Thank you.
So first of all, I want to just add some context here that on INX today, there is a company that is raising capital under a security token offering. They're called Advent Entertainment, and this is a company that owns 50% of the rights to Stan Lee, to Stan Lee's creation. Stan Lee is one of the most famous comic character and comic book creators. So we already recognize that cultural assets, entertainment, anime, comics, and so on, even sports, are very suitable projects for security token offerings. Specifically on a platform like INX, where we are very much retail oriented, and we are able to accept investors, retail investors from 90 countries around the world. It is a really solid platform for any projects who, like Questry, who are basically raising capital to create cultural assets, movies, and entertainment, and things like that. I think K-pop is a really powerful use case for security tokens, and I look forward to being able to facilitate these types of listings or even offerings. I think it's pretty exciting that Mizuho has, you know, come into the play here, recognizing the power of this asset class, and at such a time where the fund has started investing in specific projects, it would be very exciting for us to create a home on INX for these projects and make them accessible to investors all around the world, and thereby create liquidity for the projects. The self-custody model is a really important factor. If people say the future of finance, well, what does this mean? First of all, it's the right to self-determination of your assets, how you want to deploy those assets. I think we're going to see more and more collateralized lending and borrowing opportunities over the next 5 years or so. We're going to see the ability for a token holder of various assets that have value, that are proven on chain, to be able to deposit their tokens directly from their wallet into a lending protocol and borrow money against those assets. I think this is something that self-custody really makes possible. And also when we look at the model that INX employs in paying dividends to investors on behalf of the issuers that they have invested in, so at such a time where any of those projects would distribute a dividend, it is really easy for us to distribute that dividend into the wallets of the clients, of the investors that are already on the platform. So these are just some of the advantages of the self-custodial model that we have. I'll mention one more, which is the fact that we're also a cryptocurrency exchange. So any investors who want to fund their account using crypto can send the crypto from that wallet that is linked to the platform. And so we can instantly detect that the funds that are coming into the platform are coming from a specific investor, and then we can credit them the fiat balance so that they can then invest in the security tokens. So there's quite a few benefits of the self-custodial model, and we're really proud that we're able to bring that to the market. Thank you.
감사합니다. 한 가지 더 질문 드리고 싶습니다. 밥에게 질문을 하고 싶고요. INX가 이렇게 셀프 커스터디 모델을 하고 크립토를 거래를 할 수 있도록 하고 또 토큰 증권을 미국 내에서 거래할 수 있도록 하는데 그렇게 할 수 있는 이유가 라이센스가 잘 갖춰져 있다고 저는 들어서 알고 있는데 지금 보유하고 계신 라이센스에 대해서 간략하게 소개를 좀 해주시겠습니까?
Absolutely. So during the Barack Obama administration, the Jobs Act was introduced and passed by US Congress. And the Jobs Act laid out the various pathways for companies and institutions to raise capital. It streamlined the methods, specifically simplifying in some cases, the ability for smaller companies to raise capital without really complex back and forth negotiations with the SEC. So there are complicated ways of raising capital where you might work with the SEC for 6 months or even more, going back and forth on working on a prospectus. But the Jobs Act introduced easier regulations called Regulation D and Regulation S, both of which I will explain in a second. And these are called filing exemptions, meaning a company can raise capital under Regulation D from US accredited investors and Regulation S from non-US retail investors. So the non-US retail investors do not have to be accredited. Or professional investors, as they're called in some countries. They can be any average retail investor. And so a company now, let's assume Questree is now going to develop a specific project, that project will be able to raise capital from US accredited investors and regular retail investors in 89 other countries, as INX is onboarding from 90 countries in total. So, these filing exemptions, Reg D, Reg S, have made a really easy way for companies to raise capital without waiting for permission with the United States SEC. As I said, it's called a filing exemption. You simply start raising capital, and on the first day of your raise, you notify the SEC that you have started raising the capital. This is the only requirement. And companies that raise under Regulation D and Regulation S are not required to do annual filings or complex kinds of paperwork. So it really is an easy path, as I said, for raising capital. Now, to your question about our licenses, this is what the INX broker dealer can create access to. So companies that come to INX, businesses, institutions, funds, and say we want to tokenize, we want to create a security token offering using the INX platform or the INX licenses, effectively they're gaining access to these US securities laws, these filing exemptions, through the INX broker-dealer. Also, INX is an ATS, which is another license, which is a permission to trade security tokens on a true exchange-like infrastructure. So with an order book, 24/7 trading, with settlement on-chain, as well as cash-side settlement, all happening in real time. So the INX is also a secondary trading venue where these tokens that are issued in the primary offering can subsequently be listed on the ATS. Thirdly, INX is a transfer agent. So in the United States, you are required to maintain an offline copy of the registry, of the cap table of investors or token holders. So INX provides this service as well as dividend distributions, as I mentioned earlier on, into the wallets of investors. So this is facilitated through our transfer agent license. And then lastly, as I said, we're a cryptocurrency exchange. We have 49 money transmitter licenses in the United States. This means we can facilitate funding of accounts, which is we call on and off ramping, using crypto. So imagine an investor in Korea wants to purchase, let's say, the tokens of one of the Questry funded projects. They can send crypto through their wallet, and within 4 minutes, that crypto will be converted to stablecoin, and we will give them a fiat balance on the securities part of the platform. And you know, so within less than 10 minutes, an investor from Korea or anywhere in the world would be able to actually purchase these tokens. And the reverse is true as well. So they can sell tokens and convert their fiat balance into crypto and off-ramp from the platform. So these are the quite unique benefits that the INX licenses can provide to both the investors as well as to the issuers.
Thank you.
So, thanks. Thanks for your lovely lectures. Really very interesting. All of this is, STO Secure Token offering a submit. I will very enjoy. One question is actually, I'm a stakeholder in a traditional financial market. So, how could you, how to plan, convince the stakeholder in the financial market? How can you understand, make them understand, the benefits of tokenization? That is my question. Number two is actually, I'm more focused on the inflation. To be very serious now. So tokenization will can reduce the inflation, impact of inflation in the market. So this is my second question. Thanks.
Thank you. I don't know about tokenization, reducing inflation, as this is quite a macro economic phenomenon, so to say. Let me start with the first question. Convincing traditional investors to participate in tokenized markets, I think, is a matter of time, and it's a matter of the evolution of the space. So what we know is that a lot of traditional financial institutions are getting more and more inquiries from their clients saying, hey, we would like to invest in digital assets. And those digital assets could be, straight up Bitcoin. It could be we want to hold some stable coins because we want to facilitate cross-border payments or things like that. Or it could be they see something like the BlackRock Biddle Fund and they say, hey, we might already hold some crypto assets, and therefore we want to earn some interest, some yield on these assets. This is still very small, and it's probably the same crowd that are contacting their brokers and their investment advisors. So this is kind of on the demand side, given the current availability of digital assets to invest in. But if we look on the other side, the supply side, if we see more BlackRock, KKR, Hamilton Lane tokenizing more and more funds, if we see more, like my presentation from this morning was about tokenized equities, let's say we bring more and more tokenized equities from markets like India or Indonesia, and we can actually offer these at lower costs compared to traditional brokerages. If we use blockchains like Avalanche, right, where you have extremely low, if not negligible, transaction fees. Over time, more and more of those investors will contact their advisors and say, I want to invest in this fund at the lowest possible cost. And if that is available through a tokenized investment vehicle, then that's what it will be. So I guess the short answer is it's going to take some more time, but I think we're going to see more assets being tokenized and brought on chain, and therefore the demand will shift over to investors having both traditional paper-based investments as well as on-chain investments simultaneously. And again, to the question about the inflation, I think, yes, we are in a high interest rate scenario. It means, you know, treasuries are particularly attractive, fixed income products are very attractive. This is obviously very exciting for RWA today. What happens when interest rates go back down significantly? Does RWA suddenly become less attractive, specifically on the fixed income products and the US treasuries? I think these are just macroeconomic factors that, regardless of digital or traditional, people are feeling the reality of inflation. Thank you.
I just want to add one thing to what Bob just said. So if you own a stock, and when you sell a stock, how many days does it take you to get the actual payment? At least 3 days in most advanced countries. But if you use a platform like INX, you get payment right away, because in cryptocurrency, crypto tokens, the payment equals settlement. So that's a lot of value to a lot of retail investors. And that actually increases the velocity of money. So when we talk, I don't know about inflation, this might be a little distant topic, but then GDP is equal to money supply times velocity. But when we actually decrease and increase this velocity, we'll have bigger GDP. This is theoretical, but then it actually helps the greater macroeconomy too.
When I bought in Bitcoin.
죄송한데 잠시만요. 지금 okay. 그 예, 주제가 right. 저희가 지금 일본 애니메이션의 토큰화에 대해서 얘기를 하고 있었습니다. 그래서 필요하시면은 예, 다음 네, 기회를 okay. 이용해 주셨으면 좋겠고요. 이제 시간이 저희가 많지 않은 관계로 제가 조금 죄송하지만은 좀 끊었습니다. 그리고 그 캐슬리 대표님한테 제가 추가적으로 질문을 드리고 싶은데요. 아까 규제에 대해서 아까 미주호 증권이 첫 사례다 보니까 아무래도 조금 어려움이 있었다. 사실 이거는 한국도 마찬가지일 거거든요. 무슨 어떤 펀드를 토큰화하든 어떤 저항이 있을 거라고 생각하는데 일본 내부적인 레귤레이션 쪽으로는 문제가 혹시 없었는지, 그리고 이제 이거를 만약에 상장을 하게 된다면 어떤 스케줄 라인을 가지고 계신지가 좀 궁금합니다.
Okay, thank you. So the authority, from the regulation perspective, so actually I used to be working on the traditional financial field as a fixed income sales. So I like the inflation topic as well. But you know, from the regulation perspective, especially in Japan, their purpose is to protect the investors. So if the investors understand the risk of the financial products, that is fine. At all. But in Japan, it's really hard to explain the risk of this kind of, you know, contents fund or animation fund in the past. So that's why I'm taking more than 2 years to, you know, getting the information about the, you know, anime production business and the cash point of the anime production business, and taking time to explain to the, you know, Mizuho Securities compliance team, Mizuho Securities legal team. That's why it takes time. But now we already launched that kind of fund in Japan. So yes, it takes time. But the important thing is to make the investors understand the risks of this financial product. It's much more important.
끝으로 팟캐스트리에서 하시고 싶은 말씀이 있는지 조금 준비해 주시면 좋을 것 같고요. 사실 몇 초 안 남았지만 저 개인적으로 한번 묻고 싶었던 거는 그 이제 거래소 관점에서 봤을 때 여러 가지 레이어 1 플레이어들이 있는데 그중에 아발란체와 함께 협업을 한 경우를 많이 봤습니다. 그리고 뭐 최근에 리퍼블릭을 토큰화할 때도 아발란체를 사용했는데 거래소 관점에서 봤을 때 아발란체의 장점이 뭔지 짧게 좀 듣고 싶습니다. 거래소 관점에서 봤을 때 바합한테 질문을 드리고 싶네요.
So, as I mentioned just now, extremely low transaction or gas fees. I think we all feel the pain of, you know, settling on Ethereum, especially when network congestion is high, as they like to say. Avalanche, I'm not a technologist, but I know that there are significant throughput advantages, and again, that low transactional cost. This is really predominantly the benefit that we see. And when we listed the asset that you mentioned just now, the Republic note on INX, we all mutually agreed that Avalanche was the network that we would do that on. And this has effectively created quite a strong working relationship between the three parties. And as we were discussing earlier on, we are expecting that there will be more listings on Avalanche in the future. Again, if an issuer decides they want to list on a specific chain, we're not going to necessarily, you know, push them. What we do is advise and say, hey, here are the pros and the cons of these various chains that you can choose to list on. But for now, we're definitely enjoying those benefits that, you know, come with the Avalanche blockchain.
감사합니다. 지금 시간이 끝난 관계로 끝으로 퀘스트리 대표님한테 한 가지만 더 말씀하고 싶은데요. 한국에 사실은 한국에서도 웹툰이나 이렇게 IP 산업들이 굉장히 지금 준비가 잘 되고 있는데 토큰화에 대해서 좀 꺼리는 분들이 있을 거예요. 거기에 대해서 짧게 한 말씀 부탁드립니다.
Yes, so as I mentioned earlier, before the tokenization, I believe this, you know, making a new finance product is much more important than tokenization. And the tokenization or blockchain technology is the, you know, just a major to, you know, broaden the investor community all over the world. So tokenization itself is the, you know, just the, you know, major of the, you know, getting investors from all over the world. So again, making a financial product or securities first, for securities IP or anime or like webtoon or comics is much more important, and to that make investors understand the risk of that kind of product is very important. And but in Japan, 90% of the tokenization, security tokenization is from a real estate space. But if you want to invest in Japanese real estate, and my answer is if you like the Japanese anime, you will be the investors of that kind of financial product. So I think in terms of the asset-backed securities, what kind of asset you are dealing is very important. So that is, thank you very much.
모두 참석해 주셔서 감사드리고요. 여기서 마치도록 하겠습니다. 감사합니다.